Hello, everyone, and good morning. Today is Tuesday, April 7th. Michael Boutros here with you for this live intraday strategy session on SB Trade Desk. Mark, good morning to you. Eileen, great to see you guys in the room. Chintan, Leon, Christian, Chris, Adrius, always a pleasure. Mario, good to see you. All right, so have you guys been enjoying all the crazy volatility? I hope so, and I'm saying that sarcastically. Obviously, guys, it's been a quiet start to the week. Shouldn't be surprising. We talked about all this last week, guys. Start of the month, thin holiday trading. The full cycle for the opening ranges hasn't even started to set in until we get back into the U.S. session today. Remember, broader Asia and all of Europe were closed yesterday for Easter. So we're just getting into the swing of things. Euro-Aus, Euro-Yen have been in focus. They've both been playing out pretty nicely. Also, the Kiwi setup, I think Jamie posted that last night. I tried to give you an update last night, late in the night, as that thing had already broken. But there are things moving. We just need to know where to look. As far as where we're starting off the U.S. session, here we are, the dollar making a little bit of a comeback here. I want to start off just by looking at this dollar index. Patience pays with these kinds of breaks, guys. Let's take a quick look at what's going on. Before we do, here's what the relative performance so far for the U.S. dollar looks like right now to start off the session. Aussie, we talked about this one in yesterday's webinar at length. The RBA holding interest rates, bucking the Credit Suisse overnight swap expectation for a 0.25% cut, or a 25 basis point cut rather, to the headline rate, and exactly the way we envisioned it, guys. When the market is so heavily weighted on the side of a cut, the risk is to the opposite side of that. And that's exactly what happened. They held on rates and the Aussie rallied. So we're up with a 0.62% move here on the Aussie. The rest of the major counterparts versus the dollar are still trading to the downside. Euro with a 0.62 equal amount to the downside versus the dollar. And here's what the dollar index is doing. So this is the slope support range we've been watching for months. I don't want to spend too much time on this. If you bring it into a line chart, guys, there's no cleaner bounce than that. Okay. That doesn't necessarily mean that this thing is going, AWOL through the roof. It just means that for our short dollar bias on some of the dollar crosses we were looking at last week, you're going to have to be a little more patient. We're just opening up the April trade calendar month. Full market participation is back on board as we get deeper into the week, and that's still the primary objective. Now, interestingly enough, if you bring it back to a candlestick, the lows we made yesterday were the same exact non-farm payroll lows we made on Friday. Reaffirms the opening range low for the week, reaffirms the opening range low so far for April trade. Okay? And you could see this rebound take you right back. I mean, first things first, to get out of the support range. But again, the primary resistance range here, same region, that trendline resistance right off the highs. And again, that break would have us targeting, again, the high day close for the year. Okay. That being said, also take a look at this momentum trigger, which is waiting here on the daily. If this resistance holds, we see a hold back at that median line parallel, we'll be looking again for possible turnover here in the dollar. At the end of the day, we don't have enough clarity on the index, guys, but we do want to keep our eye on this structure. We've had a couple of dips below. We have not had any closes below, and that's what we need to validate a break of this multi-month formation. So the dollar still remains in a precarious position. One of the reasons I'm kind of staying away from dollar scalps per se, if you'll notice the intraday page doesn't have any dollar pairs right now. Again, throughout the week, guys, as the formations start to pan out, the opening ranges start to set, and the setups start to become a little more clear, we'll go ahead and add more positions on that. But right now, it's just not our ideal environment. So we're going to stick with the pairs that are moving. We're going to stick with the pairs with a little bit larger of an ATR and the cleaner intraday structures. And namely, Euro Aus and Euro Yen are the ones in focus. So before we move on, any questions on the U.S. dollar? Again, one of you guys sent me an email yesterday asking if I think the U.S. dollar is going to break 11.880. Again, that's not how I'm specifically trading, guys. If it breaks this support range to the downside, that is the initial target. But I can't do anything until I finally get a close below this region. And if you're asking why is the close so important, it's because, guys, that's where so much price action happens into the end of the session. And another reason is for what happened yesterday. On Friday, this looked like a break. Yesterday, at some point, this looked like a break. Hell, last week, this looked like a pretty decent break for me as well, right? So it's the close that's going to validate the break of this formation. That's still what we're waiting for on the greenback. All right, let's jump into the intraday page. First things up, euro yen. So the major premise of the position, and again, we're working on formatting, guys. There will be a change here coming up for the intraday page to, so I can make these sliders so you can just focus on today's, and if you need to go back, they won't all be kind of cluttered here. So bear with me, working with the developers on that right now, hopefully within the next couple of days. But this is the basic premise of the trade, guys. 131.35 into 131.78 has a whole host of things there. The 618 extension, a 50% retracement of the decline. You had that median line of the advance, trendline resistance off the highs. You name it, it was all cluttered in that region. So on the scalp, right, that's this region right here. We just stretched into it. By the way, this is going to actually represent a 618 extension right off the low. So that just moves off when you get off the screen. But that's the primary premise here. And then you had this proposed median line resistance, which came right into that Friday high. We were testing that as well. If you guys remember the Thursday post, we were basically looking for short exposure below this region. We didn't quite make it into the region, but you had a couple of momentum triggers that gave out. There was no opening range break yesterday because remember, European markets were closed, Asia markets were closed, and on the onset of the weekly open for US, you know, that's not where I'm going to start judging an hourly range. So you didn't have any opening range setups per se yesterday, but certainly a nice break below 70 was your first hint. And then the same support trigger we were watching from last week actually did finally give out to the downside with that move. Nothing here to play with, right? Because it's too early in the week. The actual trade was this peak in overnight trade. And I'll show you what the intraday chart look like on the 5 minute. Okay, so there were a couple of triggers that panned out. Here was the operative trigger at the highs, which is right here on a 5 minute chart. Okay, here's the open of London in green. The London opening range didn't really give you a clean break either. If anything, this would have probably been the open range break for London because it came back, he tested it as support. Again, you're not interested in playing the long side because we're right at resistance. As this thing teetered out, you had a two-point trigger that gave out, a stop against the break there against the highs, and you had the nice decline. Didn't take this. Obviously, this was in trade yesterday as it kind of broke down into the U.S. trade session. But that was your first trigger on the upside, on the downside. Here was a trigger last night right after the U.S. close as this thing came into the new lows. Wouldn't have taken the long here. This would have taken me out of the shorts. Again, you're looking for short triggers while below this. And it's important just to keep in mind, guys, what we're trying to do at all times. So I try to give you a heads up on the directional trade that we're looking for. We have our bearish invalidation level clearly set. So on these rallies, you're simply looking for short triggers while below 131.35 into that 180 level. Euro Aussie was much cleaner, and that was the one that was really the play last night. But Euro Yen, keep your eyes on that 131.35. Keep your eyes on that median line. As long as that stays as resistance, you want to be cautious. The only thing I wanted to note here as well in the daily chart is that it held 40 on this bounce. So we're going to need to see a 50 break alongside a break of this to validate keeping the upside bias in play. That being said, again, long exposure is at risk sub 131.35. All right. Any questions on the euro yen? Be nimble on these. Again, we're looking for about 40 pips, but if momentum turns over, if you get a long trigger in momentum, it's worth it just to take the profits or bring your stops in simultaneously because it's still the trading conditions are not ideal for the intraday setups just yet. So that is Euro Yen. Moving along to the highlighted setup here, and the one that really gave us some juice last night was the Euro Aussie. Obviously, that's on the back of the RBA. Listen, before we go over Aussie, let's just take a quick look at the Aussie dollar just to put things in perspective. Obviously, the euro is off today, but it was extenuated or exacerbated by this Aussie move. And here's what the Aussie dollar looks like on the daily. So we highlighted 77.09. If I'm not mistaken, that was the reversal daily close. Yes, right here. Oh, I'm sorry. That was the 2007 low. So you got to go quite a ways back to the 2007 stretch low that you made right around this region. But I'm pretty sure, I think I might have mislabeled that. Hold on one sec, guys. It's the close here. 7706. Okay. 7706, 7709. It's a 3-pip range. You're not going to argue about it. But this is the outside, or it's not an outside day, guys, but it is the reversal close candle. So you've seen a nice pivot at that region. It was also the close low that you made for February. And add to that, it's pretty darn close to that 2007 low. Long story short, it was a soft target that we had. It's exactly what we ran into. But on the pullback after a 50 break, momentum holding 40. Okay, that's at risk for a near-term pull higher still. Intraday chart looks even more interesting. Okay, here's the Aussie to start the week. Here was the formation that we were looking for to find a hold. Obviously, that didn't really give us much guidance. We're going to adjust that to that new low we just made. But there it goes. Here's the RBA interest rate decision. Okay. And as we talked about in yesterday's webinar, guys, if you just a quick reminder, Monday webinars are public on DailyFX, so we open that up to the broader audience. And again, we don't go over the setups necessarily that we're doing here in SB, but we did go over this one ahead of the RBA. The pullback, you know, as he came into the print, again, the risk was for a topside move just on account of where Credit Suisse overnight swaps were. So let me just show you guys a quick look at what that looks like. This is basically what market participants are factoring in as far as interest rates are concerned. Okay, as we head into that read yesterday, this was showing, and I think I showed you this in the webinar, this was showing a 75% chance of a 25 basis point cut last night. Okay, when the market is so heavily skewed in favor of the cut, the risk for the move obviously moves right to the other side because we've all but priced in that decline. That's what 75% means. And obviously the Aussie had come off sharply since then. So you'd only assume that that's been priced in. And if they don't cut, those bets start to reverse, hence the rally. Okay. So if you were short into this exposure, there's a little bit of a tight draw there. But, you know, they did completely buck what the expectations or what markets were pricing in. Interestingly enough, you go out for the 12-month expectation, and this is telling you what markets are pricing in as far as basis points over the next 12 months. And you saw that we were looking at negative 66 yesterday, which means that the markets are factoring in additional 66 basis points in cuts from the RBA. You can see that that changed today by positive 10. So now we've even reduced what the expectations are for cuts from the RBA moving forward. What does all this mean, Mike? This is starting like sound like a little bit of gibberish. Well, at the end of the day, the interest rate differential, the short that was based on the expectation for a cut, is softening across the board. Not only did they not cut today, or yesterday rather, or I guess it's still today in Australia, but the expectation for forward cuts or more cuts down the line, that softened too. So the market needs to adjust. We need to price in this differential. And that takes the pressure off the short of the Aussie for now. Okay. Now, what do the technicals say? Okay. The technicals say we're testing something pretty big here. This median line has been a very, very clean move. Okay, you've seen the highs get caught with the upper median line parallel a couple of times. You saw the median line right off that high from the FOMC spike. That caught support twice. Okay, it came just shy. Let me show you where this extension is from. It came just shy of a 2618 extension off the high. It came to this key support region here. This was a beautiful pitchfork that was in play for some time, right? And again, the median line was on a confluence just ahead of that. And you saw the rebound. And now the momentum signature, after all this time from the peak, 60 hold, 40 break, 50 hold, 40 break, 30 break, 60 hold, right? Now we broke the 60 barrier for the first time, and where is we finding support? Where are we finding support? Markets aren't in a static, right? This is amid thin holiday conditions. This is right ahead of interest rate decision. I'm not going to look too much into that. But here we are back at 70 again. So we'll look for support near 40. Obviously, the opening range low is going to be the invalidation level at this point. So if the opening range low for the week gives out, sayonara, okay, markets just reacted to the interest rate decision, and you'll basically have to look right back at that 75 barrier. That being said, you know, you want to be wary of jumping too far ahead on the Aussie short from here. Questions on the Aussie? when we refer this, or now that we have a picture of what the Aussie's doing near term, here's how Euro Aussie played out. Okay. Again, they're not going to always work out these scalps with such precision, guys, but when we have validation on our levels, when you have conviction on what you're doing, you see something like this happen, it all but reaffirms the setup that we're playing with. So 144.48, you had the 200-day moving average at 144, a little bit bigger of a resistance range, but nonetheless, that's the bearish invalidation level. We're not in the habit, guys, of calling highs. That's not what we're doing. And that's why it's important to distinguish the strategies that we're working with. If you're working on a swing strategy and you're taking a trade based on that, you have to open up those stops. Okay, you're not working with a 30, 40 pip stop. You're working with whatever stop is going to be designated as far as the risk to reward to maintain that. If we're scalping, it's a little bit different of a game. I need to see something break. I need to see something happen, a shift in momentum, an opening range break, to make me start looking lower. Otherwise, you know, it's just resistance. This thing could just come up here and sit for a good 3 days. Doesn't mean I should be trying the shorts, right? Well, this gave us clear-cut triggers on the downside as we came into the RBA interest rate decision, which validated our near-term expectation for a pull lower, okay? Again, so the 200-day moving average, the 618, key barrier of resistance that still remains in play. Now, on the intraday chart yesterday, here's what we look like. You had a nice ascending channel right off of that Friday low. This is the Friday post-FOMC. This is 2 weeks ago. And the 143 handle was the 50%. So this was going to be your near-term bullish invalidation level. Not to mention that we had set a pretty clear-cut opening range for the week yesterday. So the game plan was, again, we're looking for shorts into this region. I also noted that the momentum was holding this 40-60 range since the start of the week, and we'll want to see a break of that. It was a beautiful break last night as this thing gave out on the RBA. So here's what the scalp chart looks like right now. All right, so you had a very clear-cut opening range for the week. This is, again, this is 10:35 last night, so you're already a couple hours into Asia trade. Asia trade low tested the U.S. opening range session lows, or this is actually ahead of the U.S. open range. These were the U.S. lows. And you're looking for a break of this key range to open up the short side, and that's exactly what happened on RBA. It actually happened with a break of this trigger, but remember, we want to see that 40-60 level break, because ever since the break here into overbought condition, which confirms the upside, you haven't really gotten anything to invalidate the bias or the momentum signature, which remained constructive. This was it. Okay? And certainly the break below 43 opened up targets at 42.35. Next targets were at 141.67, 141.75. And then on this dip, I just want to show you this old median line formation, which almost just caught that low. Okay. And then a break above 30 to the upside again kind of takes you out of the shorts. So looking to sell rally still, nothing has changed. We'll look for a move back into 143. Initially, I'm going to look for a pivot back at that upper median line parallel, and that takes it to like 42.75. So if we get up here looking for some short triggers on the downside, but you know, as long as you stay below 143, we'll continue to favor shorts on the Euro Aus. Question on Euro Aus. Lee, are you Mutasim? If you are, I just need you to send me another Twitter request. I got your SB Squawk request form. I just need you to submit a request through Twitter if you have a minute, and we will get you all set up. He says, good morning, Mr. Michael. Can you give us a few words about the use of the ATR in our scalping, i.e. with the percent should use as a stop loss, 10% or 25% or 100% of ATR? Great question. So, Lee, here's how I use it in my trading. I'm typically looking for a quarter or 25% of the daily ATR. So if the daily ATR is showing 100 pips, typically 25 pips is what I'm looking at per scalp. Now, anytime, guys, anytime you can increase your risk to reward, it's always going to be beneficial, okay? But for my purposes, I have to at least maintain 1-to-1. And I know that's tight. That's not the average out there, guys. And that's not the common trade strategy. But then again, not everyone's scalping, right? If we talk about Jamie's trades, if we talk about the swing trades, that's always going to have a more favorable risk reward, but we're doing much less of them, right? Whereas the intraday strategy, it takes a lot more trades, and you're banking on more right trades than wrong trades. Whereas in a typical strategy on a medium-term basis, intra-week basis, you're banking on a higher probability or higher, larger winners than losers. So it's a different type of mentality when we're intraday trading. That said, I'm typically looking for 25% of what the daily ATR is. And that's just based on you have four major sessions throughout the day. You have Asia, you have Aussie, Asia, Europe, US. And on average, if we're intraday trading, those positions I'm only looking to hold, you know, one or two sessions throughout the cycle. So that's how I use the ATR. Also, Lee, it's a great gauge of volatility. So when you're trying to shift your attention to know where to look, you know, I'm going to go to, for example, a euro pound trade, right? And the daily ATR is 79 pips. That's the daily ATR. So what am I going to do? Looking for 20 pips here? Yeah, you could probably squeeze it out, but you get a whole lot of chop in this pair. So I'm not going to shift my attention here, right? Where if I go to something like a pound Aus, right, a quarter of the daily ATR is 55 pips. That's just a quarter. So it gives me a little bit more comfort with the ranges. I can open up the stops a little bit. I can get, you know, a little bit more finesse as we get into the position with taking some off the trade, bringing my stops down, etc. So, you know, it's just a gauge of volatility, Lee. It does not tell you directional bias. It does not imply anything with regards to, you know, what direction we want to be looking at. It's just a simple gauge of volatility. Did that make sense, Lee? So if we're looking for 55 pips initially, your stop is going to be at least 55 pips or closer, or at minimum, rather, 55 pips. Or, excuse me, max 55 pips, right? 55 pips or less on the stop. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean 100% I'm going to be out of the trade when I get 55 pips, right? If the trade comes into a major support barrier here, I can book a quarter, half, a third, bring my stops down to break even, and see if I can get the break. So oftentimes, the gains will be a little bit larger than what we're looking on the ATR, but on the initial trade, that's my stop. That's typically going to be my stop. One thing I want to say that's paramount, that overshadows everything I just said, guys, and this is something that we talked about last week briefly, the stop needs to be against a major level. 55 pips is the guidance. So if my stop can't be above a session high, or can't be above a major fib or a trendline resistance, if that distance is more than 55 pips, I simply can't take the trade. Okay? You talk to people all the time who say they're scalping and they're doing this. What's your stop? Oh, it's a 20-pip stop. That can't happen, guys. If you're working with that strategy, you know, donate your money to Salvation Army or something, because it's going to be very difficult for us to make profits this way. At the end of the day, if the stop can't be the designated allotage of the pip amount against a major level, then the entry is not proper. So that's something I just really want to put there as a highlight above everything we just talked about. So Lee, I hope that makes some sense. He says yes. I'm sure everyone, there are other people in the room had that similar question. So I hope that helps, guys. Steven, great to see you in the room, sir. Lee says thanks a lot. I appreciate that, Lee. Anytime. Great questions. If you guys have questions like that, throw it out. There's definitely someone who's going to have something similar. Petro says, finally some volatility. Does this mean you're going to add Sterling Aus on the intraday? I'm only putting on the intraday, guys, what I'm really currently active in looking at. If it's not there, it doesn't mean you can't trade it. It just means, for me personally, it's not my favorite setup. So the problem with Sterling Aus is this, from where we are right now. And that essentially stems from what the daily is doing, to be honest with you, not so much what the intraday is doing. I don't know what to do with that. I don't know what to do with that. At this point, specifically waking up this morning, you know, this is an outside reversal candle. After a, wow, hold on. Let me bring up, I'm not sure if I have it loaded here, consecutive bars. This is a nice quick indicator you can get also, consecutive bars that counts how many up days you've had in a row. And look what happened. You know what I mean? This is now the highest stretch of consecutive gains we've seen. Jesus, let's keep going. Since May of 2013, let's see what happened there. That had a quick interruption and a very shallow pullback before the major breakout. And of course, I remember this. This was a break of a multi-year formation here too. Okay, and that's the last time we had, you know, a 9-day stretch of advances. So I don't, you know what I mean, Petro? I don't know what to do with this outside reversal here. If it closes below 94.60, I would have to, you know, my bias from a technical factor would have to be looking lower again. But on the back of this kind of stretch, it's just, I think you just need to wait it out. I just think you need to wait it out. Not to mention that, you know, you didn't have a clear opening range break for the week because obviously Asia and Europe were closed here. But if this was an opening range, here's the Sunday open, 4-5. We just broke the opening range low and we're now checking it as resistance. And this is where you'd want to see this thing hold. This is where you'd want to see this thing hold. Remember, this is key, still critical support, 93.40 into 93.20. We came that as the Friday non-farm payroll low. That's the low we just came into. So the levels from yesterday's, from last week's report are still there, guys. And again, any scalp that we highlighted the previous sessions will always be there on the intraday page. So if we go to the Sterling Oz scalp from last week, okay, it's all the same levels. Nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. And there's that key support that we noted, which obviously last week was a break of the weekly opening range, and that's what set us on the north side to begin with. That's still the key support that we just ran into. Okay, so let's clean this up a little bit. This 2618 is not going to provide any guidance anymore. So we'll go ahead and get rid of that. Let me snap these lines for you real quick. All right. So now when you snap the lines, get a little bit more clarity. So at the end of the day, this is still the main key support barrier. Also notice that upper median line parallel that we broke, bobbled against it, tested its support. Again, that caught the low. So either way you look at it, near term, 93.18, 93.20, I think, you know, that's going to be the break that sets off a larger downscale trade. Other than that, you know, I don't really know what to do with this here. Petro, I'm going to let it sit out. If anything, this is what I'll use as the weekly opening range now. It's much larger, but it's a healthy trade. Quarter of the daily ATR is 55 pips. So over 200 pips on a daily basis for Sterling Oz. I'm willing to sit this one out. Let me get a clear range break here. Topside break is what would be great, because then you're just basically looking for 98.20. That's a nice stretch to the upside. But in the back of a flattening momentum signature like this, and on the back of an outside reversal after a 9-day advance, you know, I think we waited out, Petro. If anything, a pullback into like 92 or even this deep would be a beautiful long position. But right now, it's, you just don't have the technical clarity, I think, to get the conviction. I'm sure we'll come back to it. It'll probably pop up on the intraday one of these days, maybe this week. But right now, I'm just kind of watching this range. And remember, that Friday non-farm payroll low, again, that's the exact low we made in overnight. You got to pay attention to these guys, because these prints, again, we're not stressing the print, but this is when there's a lot of emotional trading, okay? Those major highs and lows that you put on a stretch, whether it's non-farm payrolls or whether it's not, or whether it's FOMC, that stretch into the high when the market starts to flush out those longs, or when those longs start to exit, that's a level I have to pay attention to. And when you look at the market and you find a collapse like this from 96.40 and the low is exactly the NFP low, that's something I pay attention to. Okay, so we'll keep an eye on this one for Sterling Oz. Petra says, got it. I'll also focus on the Euro Oz. I don't know if you got my tweet. I made a few pips with the RBA. Of course, beautiful. I didn't check the squawk this morning as I came in. Oh, there it is. Well done, sir. Not bad. Keep it up. Beautiful entry. Beautiful entry. My buddy David Song actually had a, we were talking about Aussie last night. for some time, and he preempted the RBA with a long position also, and worked out pretty well for him. So again, it's just playing, you know, what the market's expectations are. And interestingly enough, guys, one more note about the RBA. If you look at the consensus estimates, meaning Bloomberg polls 38, 40 analysts, the consensus was for a hold, actually, at 2.25%. It was not for a cut, okay? But if you look at the Credit Suisse overnight index swaps, those were leaning for a 75% chance of a cut. And that means that that's what the market's pricing in. The market's not pricing in what the consensus estimates from the analyst side are saying. There's a difference there. And that divergence, for me, was, again, just even more, you know, red flags that the Aussie short was probably at risk. So we'll see if the rebound here has any juice to get the Aussie for an upside swing. At the end of the day, we'll be looking at the U.S. dollar as well, as that thing continues to sit right at support. So those are the main two highlighted setups we'll be following for now. Again, God willing, we'll get some more volatility, and hopefully some more setups will come into focus as active. But again, prudence pays, guys. I'm not going to just jump into a scalp just because, you know, I'm looking for a position to take. If the setup isn't there, you know, it's not a game. We'll sit on the sidelines. Here's what gold looks like. I have to update you on this daily because it's such a critical trade at this point with where the dollar is. Look, we stretched right into a major range, 1223, 1225. We've been talking about that for a while. Here's what the daily chart for gold looks like. So 1223, just for reference, is the actual stretch March opening range. Nice pivot in price. 1225 is the basic 50% retracement of the 2015 range thus far. Again, how critical the closes are. Bring it into a line chart. Do you see where we rebounded on a close basis, guys? And this is why, long near term, the longs are at risk. And this is why our bias start to shift to the downside as we opened up the week. So we got that stretch into 1225, 1223 on an intraday basis. On a close basis, rock solid at the confluence of the median line off the lows, and a larger, longer dated median line that dates back to the 2013 calendar. Okay, so near term, longs are still at risk below this region. This is the bearish invalidation level for the immediate bias. You have a trigger. If this gives out, look for a spill to the downside. We've raised, as noted in the report, we've raised the bearish invalidation level, the bullish invalidation level from 1168 all the way up into 1195 on the back of that break that we made early in the month. So on a pullback scenario, look for support around 1195, 1197, 1196, 1198 is more accurate probably. And this is a break that would invalidate this uptrend that we're looking at off of last month's low. It's going to have a lot to do with the dollar, right, sitting at support. You can see a scenario where the dollar breaks that support. You see this thing blast through. You're looking for the 200-day moving average. You're looking for the 1245, 1250 range. And you can see the other scenario where the dollar starts to break, or hold that support and makes it through that near-term trendline resistance off the highs, in which case you look for that. You look for the gold trade to give you that pullback into that invalidation level. And again, as I said yesterday, guys, I'm not a big fan of playing that corollary play like that, but it just so happens when the trades line up, it's all but, you know, a no-brainer to keep your eye on that. Okay, so I hope that offers some clarity for those of you who are offshore or able to trade the CFD side of gold. By the way, if you're trading futures or if you are on a futures platform along with equities, the levels are going to be very, very similar. You can use these same setups, guys. There's no problems on that front. All right, so that covers the highlighted setups that we're looking at on the intraday page. Again, more will come as the markets start to move. I do want to take a moment and talk about the Kiwi dollar. I gave you guys an update on that yesterday. My man Jamie, he's so on point with some of these setups. So yesterday, you guys might have seen he put out a tweet. Where is it? It's on the Squawk. So I put this tweet out last night, and basically I wanted to highlight this tweet that Jamie had made a couple hours before, saying that we could possibly see another spike into a high here, then a move lower, a really nice confluence region. These are the kind of plays that we on the scalp side are very, very interested in. Just so happens there was a beautiful trigger into divergence with momentum that made this thing just pop last night. And here's what it looked like. Okay, I just printed the scale version, but what I wanted to show you guys was the same slope. And I'll show you this in a live chart in a moment. Remember that slope that we were watching in Kiwi for months? Well, a pitchfork off the decline here mirrored it. It just happened to come out that way. And it really puts a little bit more emphasis on the break of the opening range low that we saw yesterday. So here's what Kiwi dollar looks like now. Let me zoom this out. Boom. So remember this crazy slope up from the November highs of last year? Resistance, 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 pivots all along the side. This was the breakout, gave us a pop. We turned bearish on this break of the weekly opening range last week. There's a lot of noise, or this is 2 weeks ago on FOMC, a lot of noise. And remember, this thing fizzled. We even completely lost focus of it last week. It was a real slow-burning trade. Came into a key support structure. More importantly, here's this week. And there's that range that Jamie was talking about in that tweet, right? Divergence into the highs. Again, you're not looking at the spike high, you're looking at the close high. So bring this into a line chart real quick. Higher high, lower high, one of the highs on the extreme, one of the highs sub the extreme, the 70 region. So you're looking for this thing to turn over, you're looking for short triggers. Again, it's a dollar pair, so it wasn't going to be on one of my highlighted setups, and specifically into this range. I didn't really want to give credence to this opening range for the week on account of the thin market conditions. But a clear break sub 50 for the first time in 4 or 5 days since the beginning of the month, after some divergence, okay? And, you know, you got well over the 30 pips that you'd be looking at per scalp on this one. On the break of the opening range alone from 75.65, you know, here we are sitting at the low at 75, nice 60-pip range. So, near term, again, you showed some divergence into these lows. There's a momentum trigger break here as we're heading into the U.S. session. A break sub 75, 10, 75. You're basically looking for a drop into this zone, which is going to be a little bit more critical that it holds the median line at 74.80. A break of the European opening range highs around 75.50 with a trigger break to the upside, and you look for a little bit more recovery. I'm not going to stress this level here, guys. 75.67 is just the highs that you made, the opening range high for last week. So that's why that level has been highlighted here. If you do get the upside trigger break, you just want to tack on a quick retracement and look for the 50 and 618. And if you do that, 50 comes in at that same region, 75.70 into 75.80. So this would be a nice region of which you'd start to look to reassert the short side of the trade, specifically if momentum holds 60. So right now, bottom line, just to clear things up, you're looking for the U.S. opening range to pan out, and you're looking for a break of either of the highs for Europe with a long trigger break here, or if we break the lows, specifically if this gives up, it looks like it just gave out a trigger, guys, but you're defending this fib. So you're never going to take a trigger break into support. Support is still here. You know, that's not an operative trigger right now. It's sitting at 40, actually, so I'll be looking for a break into the U.S. Open here for the Kiwi. Remember, it's a dollar pair, guys. So, again, I'm not really crazy about playing, you know, the short side of the dollar. Not until we close below that region. Steven says, I just started the book, The Logical Trader. Question on the opening range breaks. Say, talk set? I'm not sure what you mean by talk. Set a clear range in the first 2 hours of trading, and then it broke to the upside, one pip. Would you call the opening range break, or would you want to see more of a break, say 5 or 10 pips? Steven, I wouldn't look at it from that direction at all, my man. It's not about the distance that – well, let me take a step back. It's always going to be better for you to wait that breakout and get a pullback to try to get in as close as you can to that break. The only time I'll take a break of the opening range on the actual spread break like this is if there's an opening, or if there's an event risk, meaning the market is reacting to something, you know, an interest rate decision came out, non-farm payrolls came out, CPI came out, a major read where the market is clearly making a push. This is when I'll just take a short on the break. Other than that, you're looking at the 5-minute chart, Stephen, and you want to make, you want to wait for the pullback. You'll get the pullbacks, guys. It's very rare that a market is just going to go and drop like this. Like I said, unless it's a, it's something event-driven. Oh, sorry, Tokyo. Oh, the Tokyo range. Yeah. What I do like about what you're saying is I don't want to stress the time, right? The opening range could take an hour. You could sit in that range for the first 2 hours of trade. You're absolutely right, Stephen. But you don't want to trade it like that, guys. It's not going to be as soon as you push through one pip, you're going to take a long, because you know what's going to end up happening, Stephen. You're going to get fake breaks like this, which you're going to take a long at the high of the market. And then even if it pulls back a, an insignificant amount to test that range low, you're going to get stopped out. You're going to get stopped out. So it's not just quick fingers. We want to make sure that, you know, what we're seeing is being validated. So if you miss the initial break, wait for the pullback. That's fine. I'll take the long again on a test of the opening range or a test of the break that we just made. If you don't get it, there's always going to be more opportunities. The markets will offer another opportunity somewhere else. And that's the thing that we want to keep in mind when we're intraday trading, guys. The probability or the strategy on a whole requires us to be a little bit more prudent because we're trying to get more winners than losers, per se. Our risk reward is not going to always grant us that cushion where we can have 3 out of 5 trades, 2 out of 5 trades be right and still be up, right? So we want to make sure that we're being prudent on those entries. So even on a trade like this, right, this looked like a crack of 50. I'm not going to go taking a long, you know, at this region right here because my stop needs to be way down here. But we got a pullback. And now you're testing the break level again. Now that makes a little bit more sense, right? Whereas a long here after the break is basically chasing. Is basically chasing. So, guys, I'm just showing you in real near-term price action how that works. But let me know if that makes sense, Stephen. Does that clear up your question? A great book, by the way, guys, Logical Trader by Mark Fisher, which really highlights his use of the opening range strategy on, in the commodity pits. Stephen says, okay, so better to wait for the pullback. Thank you. Yes. All right. Right on. Right on. And the other caveat I just want to throw on that, Stephen, real quick, is that even or another scenario where you would want to take the break and not wait for the pullback, if this is if it's testing some sort of major region, right? Major region. So something like this, where it's the invalidation level for our bias and it's just making a momentum trigger break, something like this I'd be interested in possibly taking the break of resistance. Okay? Why? Well, because this same trend line or just below is going to be what invalidates the long side. So on a trade like this, even if you took it at 74.60, and that you got that stretch into 74.90, right? There's that 30 pips you're looking for. Even on the pullback, if your stop is below that trend line, you're still safe. You still would have been holding that. So if it's a break of a major critical invalidation level, and that's why those invalidation levels are always put for you guys, because that's what changes our bias, all right? So something like that would be something I'd be interested in taking a break right off the bat. And some of these trades, guys, on the intraday, it's more finesse. You know, use the market conditions. If the break is in association with an opening range for the week or an opening range for the session, again, that's another scenario where you'd want to take the break. So, Stephen, I kind of just want to play the other side of that as well. You know, there are you got to be just dynamic to what the market's doing in the now. On a regular day-to-day basis, barring data, barring some sort of market event, it's always going to be more prudent to wait for the pullback to get back in. But we always have to recognize the environment, the conditions of which we're trading in. So I know I talked your ear off on that one, guys, but again, I hope that offers some clarity. Eileen says, thanks, Stephen. Great discussion. Michael, with the OR and short-term and pullbacks, thank you. More than welcome, Eileen. It's always good to get feedback. She says, talk the ears off. It's great. Okay. Philip says, hi, Michael. Hope you're well. In the example you're just describing on Euro-Yen, doesn't it make more sense if we look for a short as the price is testing the Asia low, now resistance? Philip, on the Euro-Yen, let's go and check it out. Yeah, we just talked about that, right? We just talked about that. So I'm not going to just take a short based on that, because here's the thing that you want to keep in mind, Philip. Good question. I need a trigger to put me into that short. I'm not going to just take a short because we're testing the Asia session lows, which happened to be the U.S. stretch lows we made yesterday as well, which happened to be the close of last week. That's what 130 44 represents, it's the close of the week. Did I highlight that? No, I didn't highlight that. That's the close of the week. So you're absolutely right. We are at near-term resistance, but that's, if we start selling every time price goes into resistance, we're going to get stopped out on the resistance break. We start buying every time price comes into support, we're going to get stopped out every time market breaks support, right? And that's all in dandy and good if you're working off daily charts and major key resistance and major key support. But on intraday, support's made to be broken, my man. It's made to be broken. Resistance is made to be broken. So we need something to tell us to take this short. Now, if price drifts into this level and holds 130.50 into the U.S. opening range, and you get a short trigger in momentum as we're breaking that to the downside, now I have a high to trade against. And that's where the short-term strategy kicks in. I have a designated level for an opening range high. It happens to be the low. I had a trigger in momentum. That's the short, looking for a move into 129.90. That being said, Philip, if I just sell here because we're at this level, what's to say the opening range doesn't break to the upside and just stop you out? Does that make sense? Really important that we get this stuff. These are great questions here. And in case by trigger, you mean we look at RSI break indicator. Again, that's what I use. I like to use the RSI because it's a very simple trade. That's a very simple oscillator. The equation and the derivation of it is just pure simple. Again, I like to use the lows in price action, per se, if we can, not to use the extremes. But look at this, 3-point trigger. If this breaks to the downside and we see a move sub 130.30, that might be worth it for me. I'm looking for 129.90, 40 pips. That's pretty good enough for me, right? That's this level right here, which represents a basic 38.2. If the opening range breaks to the upside, okay, and you see us clear the New York opening range here at 130.50, and then momentum breaks this trigger, well, 130.95, probably where you want to see this thing run. Don't take that word for it, though. Let's just tack on a quick retracement. Bet you it's going to be 6.8 or something to that magnitude right at that level. Oops, that's not the level we're looking for. Sorry about that, guys. And look where the 6.18 comes in, 130.82. 130.95, I'll be looking for resistance at yesterday's basic session highs, or the Asia, the European rather session highs. That's the London high, that's the Tokyo high, just above that. Does that make sense, Philippe? We've got a momentum trigger here as well. I'd probably wait for to see a 60 break in this, but you have a very clean cut New York opening range so far. Basically looking at 130.50, 130.30, it's like a 20 pip range. It says, yes, thanks, just to clarify, by break on the 5-minute. So, right, we'll want to see it move on the 5-minute, and you'll need to see that 5-minute candle close. As much as I don't want to really stress you guys do this, I do take into consideration a 1-minute chart just sometimes to see if the intraday momentum is validating what we're seeing. So, for example, look how it opens up the New York opening range a little bit clearer to see what price action is doing. And since the New York open, 60 or 40, 60, 40, 60. So it's good to be dynamic when you're looking at the times. I don't want you guys looking at a 1, 5, 30 hourly daily chart because you're going to go nuts. But it's something I'll flip back and forth for sure. Yeah. Doesn't hurt. Doesn't hurt. Philippe says, you understand the first candle closes and breaks. Understand, a first candle closes and breaks. I'm not sure what you mean by that, Philippe. Give me a little bit more clarification on that question. Permendra says, Michael, what will you say for the Euro Aus as it did not hold? So this will be short. Please look for me. Euro Aus. It did not hold what, Permendra, right? So we just, the New York opening range, guys, is just being set, right? So I don't know what you're looking at yet, Permendra, but we just failed to go test, again, that near-term resistance of 42.35. Looks like it's turning around. Momentum's holding 40. That's actually a good signal. Let's see if there's anything on the 5-minute here that's compelling. Yeah, so you have a couple of triggers I highlighted already, right? Those are the triggers I need to see before I start pressing the shorts, period, end of conversation. Guys, the point is this. You want the market, if you're taking a short, you want the market to pull back so you have that high to trade against. You need a session high. We need a peak in price action. We need a resistance level. We need something to try to place a scalp against. We can't just sell at the highs because we're at resistance, right? And this is still noise. We still haven't even opened up cash markets in the United States. So keep that in mind. You got a couple of triggers I'm looking at. This one being a little bit more iffy because it's taking the divergence into account. Typically, I like to use the trigger off the low in price. But either way, that's at the 50 level. So if that gives out, look for that drop into the 140 level, 141 handle, excuse me. All right, Adria says, hi, Mike. I need to clarity. Help. 60-40 RSI is bearish or 40-50 is bearish? Adria, 60-40 is bearish. Premendra, you're more than welcome, man. I appreciate that. 60-40 is bearish. I think you're getting a little bit confused here, Adrius, in RSI. No, I know what you're talking about. Yeah. Look, I'm not sure what you mean by 60-40. So in strong downtrends, we'll want to see support at – in strong uptrends, we'll want to see support at 40. So you can see here from the rally off the low, support at 40 and a break of 60 is what we want to see. Support at 40 or ahead, a break of 60. That keeps the focus to the upside. In downtrends, we want resistance at 60. So on the upswings, we want to see 60 hold. And we want to see multiple breaks below 40, multiple breaks below 30. When the market is holding 40, 60, as I said here, that means it's range bound. That means you don't have a clear-cut directional bias from the momentum signature. Adrius, does that make sense? So in a report, I think I said this yesterday or on the intraday page, note that the RSI has defended 40 support on this pullback. We'll want to see this change to confirm a near-term reversal in the euro-yen. Okay? And that was this thing right... let's go back to the euro-yen. That was this thing right here. Right here. So we've been holding 40 ever since that low, ever since the rally. Off the lows, right, on the pullback, 50. A bounce off 50 is even stronger than a bounce off 40, right? But these are levels you look for momentum to preserve on the pullbacks. This is where we were yesterday. We came back. We tested 40 as support, rock solid, which is why we were looking. And we said, you know what? We'll want to see that change to confirm the turnover here. Well, it did break, but that wasn't really a conviction break, and we're right back at this resistance trigger. Here we are. For Philippe, you know, we were trying to take a possible short here at the highs for Asia. It looks like you're going to pop through, man. So all that means, look for a short higher up. Look for a short higher up. This is still the bearish invalidation level. This is still the bearish invalidation level. And another reason why we need to see triggers to put us into these positions. And there's that, where's the euro-yen? There's that euro-yen trigger that we looked at the very beginning of the webinar. Still in play. Still in play. So, guys, I hope this discussion has been helpful for you who are just getting started or trying to get your feet a little bit more wet on the intraday strategy. Keep them coming. Again, as a quick housekeeping note, I will be on vacation on Thursday through Tuesday of next week. I will be going down for a wedding in Miami, so I won't be back till Tuesday. I will have some intraday updates on the intraday page, but we won't have a webinar until Wednesday of next week. So just a quick note on that. Jamie's back in full swing, so the swing side of things will be completely going. No change on that front. So we have a couple of seconds left here, guys. If you have any questions, if you have any specific pairs you do want to look at, just a quick note on some of the commodities. I know that's been in focus as everyone's looking at what's going on. I showed you guys, and by the way, the gold chart at the bottom of the intraday page is updated now with the weekly. I just wanted to show you again from a weekly standpoint. You know, we're coming in some interesting regions here, and I wouldn't be surprised if you get one more stretch. Look at the momentum on the weekly, touching 50, and on the daily, you got a pending support trigger. Okay, so there's a couple things that you're looking at here with gold. As far as the euro crosses, I do want to just take a quick note about the euro dollar. Again, the barrier of resistance that we were talking about since the start of last month is still the focus as we open up this month's trade. That's basically 109.16 to 109.97. Guys, clear as, you know, as far as what the market has done. I'm not talking anything about what we're doing. I'm talking about just what the market has reacted to our levels. That's conviction. Okay, that's conviction. Watch the closes, and that's the barrier of which will set off a much more prominent, in my opinion, euro recovery back towards 110.90, 110.11, 20 would be the first target, and then the longer median line parallel there, just above. All right, so those are the majors. We'll be looking at data out of the United States later today. Here's what the economic docket looks like. We're looking for that jobs or JOLTS jobs data that comes out at 10 o'clock. Print of about 5,007 we're looking for February, a little bit higher than the previous read. Not something I typically stress by any means whatsoever, but everyone's going to be looking now for more information on the health of the labor markets after Friday's non-farm payroll. Everyone's asking, was that a one-off? Is that something that's an onset of a new near-term trend that we're seeing? The participation rate, which continues to decline back to the levels we haven't seen in over 30, 40 years. All these things kind of come into question on a print like Friday's. So any jobs data, guys, just keep it in mind. It's not going to be something I'll be a tradable event, but if there's a big miss, it's going to exacerbate the dollar. It's going to really just weigh down, okay? GSA, say again, is there a webinar tomorrow? Yeah, we're online tomorrow, guys, 8:30, no change. Thursday's webinar we won't have a Thursday webinar this week. And Jamie's webinars are going to be normally scheduled. Okay, so watch the jobs data there again at 10 o'clock. The major hitter is going to be tomorrow with the FOMC minutes. You know, I had a lot of discussions with other guys on some desks. Guys, I'm kind of mixed on that read because I don't really think we're going to get anything concrete and new. We just got the quarterly projections. We just had a presser where everyone was pressing at the presser. Everyone was pressing Janet Yellen to see what her stance is. But my point being, you know, that's another one that's going to be like the jobs data. It's going to be something you just want to keep an eye on unless there's something prominently displayed where one of the Fed members really suggests that there is a major concern for either a slowdown in inflation or the stronger dollar are key topics we will be looking for in the minutes to see if there is a really a deeper concern within the committee that might hold them off from normalizing. That being said, you know, Wednesday's event risk tomorrow at 2 o'clock with the release of the minutes is probably going to be your biggest event for the week. All right. Some comments here. Are there any major specific definitions of major or key terms? What do you mean by that, Mark? We can add something like that. If there's something that you feel would clarify, what do you mean by major or key terms? You talking about data, Mark? Are you talking about levels? So levels turn key or major when they're confluence. So when if for example, we come into the 11th and the 12th and market is trading into this region, this would be critical. This would be key. Why? Well, it's essentially the close high for the month. It's a 618 extension. It's a 50% retracement, and it's a trend line. So you have both technical structures and major key levels all lined up. This would be a key level. On a reversal break, let's say the euro breaks down, what would be key support? For me, it would be this level here at 105.67, the low day close. So the low for the year, a multi-year low that was made, the close of that session, for me, that's going to be critical. That's going to be a key major level. But most of the time, whenever you hear me or Jamie say that there's a critical level or a key threshold, it's always because there's some sort of technical confluence. Either it's a major high or low, it's a fib level, it's a trend line, and they're all converging. These breaks will, I don't want to say always for in trading, but will typically give you major, major runs and a little bit more of a prominent, more defined move. What would be an example of that? And by the way, if you hear that ringing in the background, that's the U.S. markets just coming online right now. This is a key level, okay? This was a key level here in sterling yen. It's a 50% retracement from the decline off the highs you made essentially for December. And then you had another confluence with these trend lines and that lower median line parallel, and they converged right there. When that break happened, it was late in the week, but it was the onset of a much larger move into the lows. That's a key level break. And when that break happens, it becomes key resistance. And that was the exact FOMC high that we spiked into. When you use both terms, is it more important? It might be just redundant, to be honest with you, Mark. If it's a key level or a major level, man, just know if it breaks. And here's the thing. It's not always that we're banking on the break. It could be a beautiful inflection. So into that level, for example, we played the break here, right? This was a nice one. In this level, now it's the inflection. You're looking for that to hold as resistance. But don't stress if we use both or one. If it's something important, it's just something we're trying to highlight as, hey, watch this. If something happens and this is invalidated, it's going to change our outlook moving forward. Okay. Mark says, okay, thanks. Just redone. Yeah. It's just trying to stress, putting a little bit more emphasis on it. So guys, I'm going to end it there because if we go over an hour, sometimes there's a problem archiving these. So I'll let you, go. Again, we'll be here tomorrow, 8:30 Eastern, to kind of cover what's going on to the end of the week. Some comments here from Eileen says, really helpful for those not so new even. Enjoy your vacation and wedding. I appreciate that. Petra says, even the best of us need a small vacation time to time. Good day to you, sir. I appreciate that, Mark. Petro, have a good day, guys. Best of luck trading, and I will see you bright and early tomorrow morning for another webinar. Cheers.